after we took this long sort of holiday or doing our solo stuff, we decided that we'd only come back together if we really wanted to. And we felt that we really wanted to. We just came into the studio and things just evolved naturally, straight away. So we were hungry for it. And it felt like the early days. And that's why we got very sort of excited. And out came a whole load of tracks.
In 1989, the doctors told him that you stop everything, the cigarettes, the drink, everything. You stop and you will have a bit more life. But they had also told us at that point, be prepared that Freddie will not see Christmas.
Ladies and gentlemen, of course, the top band of the 80s are Queen.
Innuendo was actually seen as a real critical return to form. And Innuendo was the first number one they'd had since Under Pressure.
This year's special award for an outstanding contribution to British music goes to Queen.
There was absolutely no impression from me that he could have been sick. He was full of beans and singing away.
There was a feeling of sort of re-exploring our youth almost, buried in there somewhere, and it was fun. We were all working really flat out on everybody's ideas and not being kind of possessive about things, so there's quite a liberation there. Actually, we had some fantastic times, and we were a very close-knit group, like a family, and we would work in the studio until Freddie got very tired. You make me smile when I'm just
about to cry. He had more concern about his cats than he did about most human contact. You make me laugh and I like it. He would much rather, if he was on tour or away recording or something, talk to his cats than he would friends, and he really would. He would call them up. He would call up whoever was in the house at home and expect to talk to one of the cats. Yeah. They were his babies. His cats were his babies.
Would you like to have children, for example?
I can buy them. Of course I would like to have children. I'm just being very frivolous and flippant. Yes. But yes, I would. Yeah. With the right girl, yes.
It's nice, isn't it? Yeah. Oh, you're not even taking him.
He was having radiation therapy, but he had to do that about 5:30, 6 o'clock in the morning, because it had to be done at the hospital. It could not be done at home. But it had to be done when as few people as possible were around to see him going in there. Yet he would still go home, have a couple of hours rest, and go and make music.
When we did discover that Freddie had this terrible AIDS virus in his body, there was still a disbelief in us. You know, you think, no, it can't happen to our mate, it can't happen to Freddie, you know, there's going to be some way out of this, you know, he's going to be cured. And right up to the last minute, I think it was, we knew, but we didn't know. We sort of refused to know, if you like.
Do you ever worry that you could end up a lonely, rich old man when you're 70?
No, because I would be dead long before that.
You don't expect to make old bones?
No, actually, I really don't care. I have lived a full life, and if I'm dead tomorrow, I'm only the dead.
The man was so strong that you couldn't even tell he was sick, really, honestly. And finally he said, well, I have to sit down now for singing. I went, maybe I'm stupid, but... Maybe I was just trying to ignore it, really. Maybe I couldn't believe it. I didn't want to believe it.
The last time we met was approximately 10 days before he died. And he and I had a long meeting. And I talked to him about preparing a press release. which he didn't really want to talk about. And he said, well, whatever you want to do, dear, I don't mind, because what he wanted to talk about was his music still, because even at that very late stage in his life, the music was the one thing that brought him to life.
It never really sank into me, you know, up to, I suppose, the last probably 2 weeks that he was dying. I think I really carried on my normal work just to keep myself occupied. I didn't want to go absolutely crazy, you know, thinking about it all the time.
And they phoned me up, like, 2 weeks later. This is the Daily Mirror. Do you know that Freddie Mercury's dying? Do you have anything to say about it? And it was weird. He didn't seem like he was dying. To me, he was full of beans, right to the end.
The sicker Freddie got, the more he seemed to need to record, to give himself something to do, you know, some sort of reason to get up. And he would make it in whenever he could. So it really, it was quite a period of fairly intense work, actually.
You know, Freddie's becoming weakened by this horrible disease and he finds it hard to stand up a lot of the time. But he'll throw a couple of vodkas down and he would prop himself up on the mixing desk and have his mic there and go for it.
Roll camera, roll playback.
Sometimes I get to feeling I was back in the old days, long ago.
I can hear the voices getting thinner.
Things seem so perfect, you know.
I think you can really tell that it's an ailing voice. Although he hits the notes, you know.
The sun was always shining, we just lived for fun. Sometimes it's...
Roger started off writing These Are the Days of Our Lives about his kids and the way he felt about life and how it comes back. But of course, in that context, it had another meaning.
Those were the days of our lives.
He looked so ill, it was quite scary. And I thought that was a very brave thing to do, and why not, you know?
He spent hours and hours and hours in makeup, sorting himself out so that it would be okay.
I did too many movements.
I think so too.
But I just wanted to see.
No, I know. I'm just putting
my. I still love you.
And then the chorus.
I just want to see this. It doesn't
look kind.
It doesn't look. I think it should be wasted. Do you know what I mean? I mean, I want a little bit of shape. I'll tighten it.
Yeah, yeah. I like the shape.
Freddie actually kind of says a goodbye in that song.
I still love you. I still love you.
The music world has been paying tribute to Freddie Mercury, the lead singer of the rock group Queen. He died last night, 24 hours after confirming he was suffering from AIDS.
I turned on teletext and it said, rock star Mercury dies of AIDS, and I wept and howled and shrieked and I cried all night. The night after he died, I went to One Logan Place. There were probably 100 people there and people were just crying and comforting each other. And it was just incredibly sad.
Why did you want to come today?
Well, just to pay our last respects to him, just to show what sort of person he was, a person that everyone loved and never hurt nobody.
I wrote on a note, There Can Be Only One, which, of course, is a slogan from Highlander, which is a film that Queen did the music for. And I pinned the note on the door and I lit a candle. And Queen music was blasting out of the house, but it was just the saddest, saddest, saddest thing.
Why have you come?
I can't answer any questions.
Some say the greatest gift Freddie Mercury left behind was his public acknowledgement that he had AIDS. Just 24 hours before he died, he ended speculation about his health by issuing a statement saying he was HIV positive.
I think the press had their final bit of sort of vitriol against Freddie at that time, you know. Which is amazing, you know, that we had some nasty reports, you know, saying, some of them even saying that he kind of deserved to die because he had a promiscuous lifestyle, you know, quite unbelievable things people wrote. So Roger and I went on television to just sort of set the record straight, really.
Everybody's become instant experts on the life and past of Freddie Mercury, be they in the papers or be they on television, the commentators. Where did they go wrong and where did they go right in their assessments? You first.
Well, I mean, it's been quite distressing to read some of the reports in the press.
Yes, I mean, it would be wrong of us not to say that he has been depicted in certain quarters as a sort of decadent, wild, bisexual, irresponsible lover.
Certainly the Freddie we knew wasn't wildly promiscuous. He wasn't consumed by drugs, any of these things that people are saying. He had a very responsible attitude to everyone that he was close to, and he was a very generous and caring person to all the people that came through his life. And more than that, you can't ask.
Well, I tell you, we do feel absolutely bound to stick up for him, because he can't stick up for himself anymore, so, you know.
Well, I think you can't defend anybody in the context of having Paul Daniels sitting next to you.
Were you a fan of Queen and of Freddie Mercury?
Well, no, because I wasn't a fan of any music. I just did put my head down, I should imagine, like you did into music. I put my head down into magic.
What a dick!
And can I equally say that I'm not giving any of the royal family magic lessons, which I read in the paper this week. Thank you.